violated it, they were going to get 75 lashes. That was a fatal amount of abuse, of punishment. Now, some of the sailors knew perfectly well that this was wrong. In fact, his map maker, Juan de la Cosa, who signed this oath, as soon as he got back to Spain, drew a map up which showed perfectly well that Cuba was in fact an island. And when word of this pact got back to Spain, some of the cosmographers there began laughing up their sleeves at Columbus and, you know, thought he had gone too far.
He brought some of the natives back to Spain.
Well, he did. He tried to. He did bring back a few as trophies or offerings to Fernand and Isabella, but it didn't work out that well. But let me just back up and explain a little bit of background. He had come from Genoa, as I mentioned a few times. Slavery was, or indentured servitude, was very common there. Most households that could afford it, and Genoa was a very small city-state at the time, had one or more. They were often from Eastern Europe, and they were often concubines. You had mentioned quite rightly that when Columbus first laid eyes on the Taino, he was very impressed by them. They survived very well. They were very accomplished. They were very handsome. The women were beautiful. He was impressed by how resourceful and intelligent they were. But then almost in the same breath, and you can see that in the diaries, which I quote in my book, he said, ah, wouldn't they make great slaves? So to that end, he sent back a ship filled with potential slaves to Ferdinand Isabella. And their reaction was not one of gratitude. They immediately turned around and sent them back to the Caribbean. They didn't want slaves, partly because it was just after the Spanish Inquisition, and that was all about purification. Well, here was a whole new group of outsiders coming, and they didn't want all the problems they brought with them potentially to come along with them. And so it wasn't so much on humanitarian grounds that they refused these potential slaves, but on political grounds. It just wasn't part of their vision of a pure Castilian or Spanish empire.
And didn't they also come back with stories about Columbus, that he hadn't been that great treating
them?
Right. And yet they had been afraid of what were sounded like cannibals.
Yes, there's two parts of that. The stories that various sailors brought back from the four voyages about Columbus were highly upsetting to Ferdinand and Isabella. In their original instructions to him, they had ordered him, in very clear language, to treat people that he found well. After all, they were planning to convert them to Christianity. And the slaves were kind of, the slave idea was sort of out of bounds, because he could either convert them or enslave them, but not both. You can't have converted slaves. And they wanted the converts, not the slaves. But when the stories of various atrocities and cruelty got back to the court in Spain, Columbus's enemies kicked in and started lobbying for his removal from this august post of Emperor, Admiral of the Ocean Sea. And actually, by the beginning of his fourth voyage, he had been demoted. That was a voyage that he financed on his own and was kind of an unperson. He had been overtaken by his discoveries in the matter of only a few years. About 8 years later, he was already becoming kind of made himself obsolete.
And he was interesting. He was also somebody who believed in nepotism, because he brought his brothers.
Right, right.
And he brought his sons.
Right, right.
And so he had them as sort of a coterie around him.
Yes, yes.
Where he then didn't socialize with the others.
Right. They all did that. Any captain who went on these voyages in the Age of Discovery brought as many family members as they could, because that's who they really trusted, and that was their main ally, and that's a very important bond among them. But there's a lot to say about what his family members contributed. For example, one of the brothers he brought along was Bartholomew. And it seemed to me that he was perhaps smarter than Columbus, and he was considered at least as capable as Columbus. And the nickname that the other Spaniards gave him was the leader. He was more measured. He had a better sense of judgment. He didn't hear voices and things like that. And we don't remember much about him. One of the unusual things about Columbus is all the irrational, crazy things about him, that he thought after four voyages he was still going to China, that he thought that God was speaking to him, and he thought that he could sail uphill on his third voyage, on and on, are what made his voyages so memorable and really gave them their lasting impact. Whereas nobody remembers rational Bartholomew. The other family member who was quite important was his son Ferdinand. This was a son he had by another woman, not his Portuguese wife who died young, by a so-called natural son, who went along on the fourth voyage, which turned into a sort of Robinson Crusoe adventure where he and a small group of sailors and the son Ferdinand, who was about 16 at the time, were stranded on a beach in Jamaica trying to stave off Indian attacks. Ferdinand, when he got older and survived this voyage, amassed the largest library in private hands in Spain. At that time, one index of a nobleman's wealth was how many bound volumes they had. And Ferdinand had the largest, so that was impressive. He also wrote the first biography of his father. Columbus himself was a terrific or dedicated self-publicist and self-promoter and sort of exaggerator as well of his accomplishments. But Ferdinand's biography has a remarkable firsthand account, and it's very measured. In a way, he's trying to restore his father's reputation, but he gives a more even-handed account of the events that actually occurred, and all later generations of biographers in almost all languages have drawn on that. That's yet another important primary source.
And Bobadilla, who goes over and sends him back.
Right.
I mean, the thought and the image of Columbus coming back in chains is something I did not know. I think most people who read this book will not have known about it.
Yeah, by the end of the third voyage, he was in such disgrace, and the concern about his misrule as an administrator, not as a sailor where he excelled, but as an administrator in the Dominican Republic, had reached the point that Ferdinand Isabella sent an inquisitor to find out what was going on. And this was Francisco de Bobadilla, who had impeccable Inquisition credentials, went there to investigate, found Columbus guilty of all sorts of corruption, and humiliated him by seizing all his property, all his books and his writings, and essentially booting him out of the country. Columbus went home in chains. Now, there's an interesting wrinkle in that. Once Ferdinand and Isabella heard that he had been manacled, they wanted those manacles struck off because they didn't want to make an example of him. Columbus was also at the same time becoming more and more devout. In fact, he became a Franciscan friar. He joined a lay order of the friars, wore the Franciscan habit, and went around in the habit and the manacles, which made it very hard to prosecute him and to convict him and, you know, hold him to a trial, when he got back to Spain. So when he got back to Spain, finally he got word that would he please take off the manacles, which he did. But interestingly enough, he kept them in his possession and was buried with them. He wanted them buried to be buried with them in his coffin because they meant something to him. But there was a kind of an exhibitionistic mortification of the flesh, which was a common practice at that time, which Columbus practiced in full, partly as an act of penance, and partly as a kind of a somewhat cunning strategy of survival in Spain in that intensely religious climate.
He dies in 1506.
That's right.
And he had been in agony from arthritis and probably the gout.
Right.
But once he is buried, he's not buried. His bones keep being dug up and being moved from place to place.
Right. You know, this is one of the mysteries about Columbus is, you know, where are his remains? They're probably in several places. His heart might be in one place and the rest of his remains somewhere else. There are stories which I recount in my book. Some might be in Cuba, some might be in Seville, some might be in the Dominican Republic. We don't know for sure. We do know that his son Ferdinand is in the Cathedral of Seville. There's a big monument there. But perhaps one of the most important effects or remains of Columbus, if you will, is also in the Cathedral of Seville, and anybody can go there. It's the Columbian Library. This is where the books that belong to Columbus and his son, who I mentioned earlier, are stored. Not all of them were saved, but thousands of them were saved, about 10,000, and they're able to be consulted there now by anybody who wanders in. So that was a very important part of his legacy. So Columbus was a complicated figure. There was something of the conquistador about him, of the religious zealot, and also something of the scholar. So a very complicated, many-sided figure.
And can I add a little bit Don Quixote?
I think so. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I thought about Don Quixote a lot when Columbus was sailing uphill during the third voyage north of Venezuela, thought he was approaching terrestrial paradise. That seemed like an image that could almost be a maritime Don Quixote, yeah. Yes.
Lawrence, it is a brilliant book. It is going to win awards, I am sure. And you can't put it down because Columbus is like he walks out of a movie scene. But I thank you. Will you
thank
autograph
you.
My
pleasure.
Book for
Thank you
me?
Very much.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can link into YouTube that will also have this show and the last 200 we've done. Or you can link into Claremont Graduate University Digital Library. They have already digitized, I think, 1,200 of the last shows. So wherever you are, you can get a chance to meet the author. But support your library. That is our finest democratic institution. We'll see you next time. Thank you so
Thank
very
you.
Much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.